Hello and welcome to Healthy Hernando. My name is Ann Gail Ellis. I'm a health educator with the Hernando County Health Department. Today's topic is male breast cancer, and I have with me Mr. Herb Wagner, who is a local part-time resident here in Hernando County. He is also founder and president of A Man's Pink, which is a men's breast cancer advocacy organization. And we've got a lot to talk about today. I want to go ahead and jump right in. But Mr. Wagner, I'd like for just a minute to talk about how it is that I got you here on today's show. I was working one day at my desk, you know, saving lives and stamping out disease, that kind of stuff. And Brenda Frazier, who is the county public relations coordinator, called me and said, "Hey, I just heard a gentleman speak. It's a really interesting topic. I think he might be a good one for your show." So that's pretty much all she told me, except your contact information. And so I've since been in touch with you. So what I'd like to do is start the presentation off with just a little bit of what you were presenting to the county commissioners the day that Brenda met you, and then we'll talk a little bit about your personal story.
Thank you. Well, on that day, I was receiving a resolution to designate the third week of October as Male Breast Cancer Awareness Week in Hernando County. So the County Board of Commissioners designated October 17th to 23rd as Male Breast Cancer Awareness Week in Hernando County.
Is that a nationwide?
No, right now that was just for Hernando County. Hopefully this spring we have a representative from this area who is going to introduce it into the Florida House. And we have Jeannie Brownwaite introduced in July to the U.S. House a resolution to the same effect, and that's in the process of getting support and co-sponsors.
Very good.
So hopefully it will go federal or nationally. There was a gentleman who introduced it, Chris Conyers, who I met through our website, introduced it into Pennsylvania a week ago, and Pennsylvania did the state. So
okay,
we're starting to get there.
This is exciting.
Yeah.
Now, this topic is very personal to you. Can you tell me a little bit why you're so passionate about this particular topic?
Well, because I am a 5.5-year breast cancer survivor. And 5 years ago, I knew nothing that men could get breast cancer. I was totally shocked the day that the surgeon told me after the biopsy, "You have breast cancer and should undergo a mastectomy as soon as possible." And, you know, after the surgery and started to recovery, I went on the internet and tried to find out what I could about this disease, and there was literally no information available.
Now, male breast cancer, if I'm not mistaken, is fairly rare. Am I safe to say it's rare?
It is very rare. It's about 1% of all breast cancer is diagnosed in men. In other words, in the United States, about 2,000 men this year will be diagnosed, and about 200 men in Canada. And as a result, there will be 450 men in the United States, and about 45 men in Canada will die from breast cancer from this disease this year.
Because you don't hear about it very much. You're the first person I've ever met who actually has had it that I knew of. Now, you said some men, it's a very private matter for them.
Yeah, it's more... 5 years ago, I couldn't find any information, and there are very few men willing to talk about it. And that's why my daughters and I launched a website to provide all the information we could, so that if a man does get diagnosed with a disease, he has somewhere other than his surgeon to turn to and to try to get information and support.
Mm-hmm. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the risk factors and things like that for folks who are tuning in today. But I also want to relate them back to what your lifestyle has been to see, is there any connection? Did you have any of the risk factors that the...
Well, yeah, I mean, we all tend to overeat and are a little overweight. And, you know, at one time we probably all smoked and drank a lot of... I worked for a brewery for 25 years, so alcohol consumption was a little higher than average. And those are all risk factors, or some of the risk factors.
Mm-hmm.
But there was absolutely no history of any cancer in my family or any breast cancer whatsoever. There are risk factors can come from the environment. Certain jobs can create risk factors. And being an analytical chemist where I spend a lot of my time in the lab, you always tend to think, well, was it that? Was it this? Was it because I worked in a lab? Because I drank too much? Or as a scientist, and I have a little different philosophy in seeing that, you know, everybody is predisposed to disease, whether it's cancer or heart disease or whatever. And certain people get it and certain people don't. It's sort of in your genetic makeup. And I guess it's maybe not the luck of the draw or the roll of the dice, but it's what life has in store for you.
Okay, so Liz, you said obesity or overweight, alcohol, it might be a risk factor.
Right.
Smoking,
yes,
might be a risk factor. You said family history?
Family history and genetic history, BRCA1, BRCA2 mutations can be contributors to breast cancer in both men and women.
Okay, and BRCA1 and BRCA2, are they genes?
They're genes that undergo mutation.
Okay, all right. Let's talk about, now you said you had no family history. When we're talking about male breast cancer, does that mean just male family history of breast cancer? Or
Female. Any history of breast cancer in the family.
Okay. Yeah. All righty.
Can be passed down.
Now, when you first approached your physician, did you notice some abnormality and approach your physician, or did he just catch it on a whim? Or?
Well, that's quite an involved story, and it shows that how much we need to get awareness out, even to the medical staff, because in 2004, I had a hip replaced in May and a shoulder surgery in August. And in September, I started to notice near the end of September, there was a change in my right nipple. Well, I didn't go to the doctor right away because I had a physical set up for 3 weeks later before I headed south for the winter. So I went into my family doctor in Ohio. And during that physical, I said, hey, look, that nipple looks kind of funny. I knew nothing about inverted nipples or the fact that men could get breast cancer or anything. And he looked at it and he said, well, that's interesting. It's nothing to worry about. Wouldn't be concerned. So I came south, down to Brooksville for the winter. And very, very fortunately, about 5 months later, I went in to see a new family physician down here about a cyst in my neck. And when I took off my shirt, he asked me about the inverted nipple, and I said, well, the doctor in Cincinnati said it was nothing to worry about. He left the room and came back 5 minutes later saying I was scheduled for a mammogram. Now, there's something every man should experience.
Mm-hmm.
And I went for that. That was Wednesday. I went for the mammogram Thursday. He called me at home Thursday night and said, hey, there's a lump in there, and I've arranged for a surgeon friend of mine to do a biopsy the next day. That was Friday. Monday morning, I was told I had breast cancer.
Now, could you feel the lump?
Oh, I could. It was an inverted nipple.
Okay.
Yeah. So, which is the once after I had surgery and that, I went on and looked on the internet. That was the one thing I found about breast cancer is inverted nipples.
Okay, that's interesting. Yeah. Now, compared to women, I realize that probably men aren't, one of the things that you're trying to do is encourage people to do maybe male breast self-exams as women are encouraged to do
it. Right.
Because although it's rare, there's a possibility that men can get breast cancer. Tell me about the diagnosis men compared to women. I know that women get regular mammograms after a certain age.
After 40.
Or we encourage them
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's no need for all men to go and get mammograms, but there is a need to be aware that if you notice any change, anything that doesn't look the same, or if you feel anything, mm-hmm. get it in, get it looked at, because early diagnosis is the key to survival. So if right now the survival rate for men is about 76% compared to about 87% for women, and that is only simply because it's diagnosed later. And the survival rate is dependent upon how much it's grown.
Mm-hmm.
So if you get it caught in the early stages, your survival rate is going to be good. I'm almost six years now. And I paddle with breast cancer dragon boat teams, and there's some women on there that are 80, 85 years old that are 30-year survivors. It can be the same for men.
Yeah. Do we have... Well, tell me a little bit about the process of diagnosis. You said the doctor noticed an eye examination showed him there was an inverted nipple, and then you went for a biopsy.
Right.
Is at that point, is that where it's diagnosed?
No. Once the sample is sent in, then it has to go through to the pathologist, where they do the sections and determine what type of cells are in the tumor. And that's where it's diagnosed. And originally, I mean, like, right within, by Monday, from Friday to Monday, I was told I had breast cancer, but it was probably 2 or 2.5 weeks later before they said it was invasive stage 2-3 estrogen progesterone receptive positive, so that they knew exactly what the tumor was and how it would be treated.
Okay, and in your case, how was it treated?
Because it was estrogen positive, then I was treated with hormone therapy without the need for chemo or radiation therapy. So I underwent 5 years of therapy on Arimidex, which is a hormone, because it was an estrogen positive tumor.
5 years?
5 years.
Wow. Okay, now, so that, you've since been off about, what, 6 months, eight
yes,
months?
Yes, almost okay. 6 months.
Okay.
And it's quite a change, because hormone treatment and hormone therapy also, I mean, chemo and radiotherapy are really have dramatic effects, traumatic effects, period. But hormone therapy also has some very serious side effects, which a lot of people suffer, depression and mood swings and joint pain. So it has its downfalls as well. But
before we taping, we were talking a little bit about how sometimes when you were on hormone therapy, you became very emotional.
Well, my daughters told me I became a much better man because I became in touch with my feminine side. In that, I mean, I had dramatic mood swings, which I had never had before, and depression. But I would cry at the drop of a hat. I could be sitting watching Bambi, and all of a sudden tears would be rolling down. And it's a good thing I live alone, you know. Because it was difficult to deal with.
Now, you were able to come off of the treatment at 5 years because you were diagnosed as cancer-free?
Last October, my oncologist started talking about the fact that there is some evidence now that hormone therapy can continue on for 10 years. They can increase by about 2% the chances of non-reoccurrence. When I talked to him in October, I was thinking about it, but by the time March and April came around, I was really, really down. And my joints were aching tremendously, and I thought, you know, to gain 2%, say, there's a 95% chance of no reoccurrence under the treatment I had. Mm-hmm. I could possibly increase that to maybe 97%, but another 5 years on that drug, I chose not to take the other 5 years.
Yeah, it's a quality of life issue.
It is, and that's how the decisions are made on how they treat. Originally, he said that, you know, you got a 95% chance no recurrence going on hormone therapy. Chemo might increase it, but it might kill you too.
Right.
You know, so it's always a balance of benefit versus side effect.
Now that you've come off the medicine, what is your regular follow-up with your physician? Are you required to have annual mammograms?
Yes, there was something in the other breast originally, and that's been followed. It was followed every 6 months for the first 3 years, and then yearly. Mm-hmm. And I have an oncologist visit now once a year, and a family checkup twice a year.
Now, because you've had a breast cancer. Are you at increased risk for other types of cancer?
They say yes, and specifically, usually prostate. Men with breast cancer are at higher risk for prostate cancer.
Okay, so you're very aware careful with your PSAs.
And, yes.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Let's talk a little bit about support for someone who's diagnosed with male breast cancer. I went online to see what I could find, and most everything is really geared toward women. And I know that has something to do with your mission now. Tell me a little bit of what kinds of support might be out there for anybody who's got this diagnosis.
Well, there are a couple of other male breast cancer awareness organizations. I'm working very closely with one out of Maryland, out of the Shadow of Pink, which is run by Kathy Reed, who lost her husband Joe at 47 years old in 2008, and they formed this Out of the Shadow of Pink in order to increase awareness. And the Brandon Greening Foundation, he's a 38-year-old male battling stage 4. So there is some information available. But that's why my daughters and I looked, and I had a very dear friend in Ohio, and she's passed from ovarian cancer, but she was always giving back to others. And when I was diagnosed, she said, "Herb, you know, you're in a great position now to help other men. Do something with it, because you can go out there and you can talk about it and you can increase awareness and help save other men or from, you know, it." Excuse me, can we just pause for a second? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
Whenever you're ready.
Yeah. No, going back with Barbara was always giving back to others and taught me that, hey, you can help. Just go out and talk to people. Tell them that men need to know that breast cancer is a disease they can get. If they get it looked at, they're going to be better off than if they let it go. And so that's how we got to the point that we started to put up a website, and because my youngest daughter is a senior pathologist assistant, she has a lot of access to people, doctors, and oncologists. And we were able to start a website along with information from the American and Canadian Cancer Societies, which I think is very, very up to date with all the most recent information we had 2 years ago.
Until I looked at your website, I just had no idea. So I want to encourage everybody to go on your website. And it's malebreastcancer.ca is the website. And one of the things, and you just referenced it a few minutes ago, about how when you were diagnosed and started researching it, one of the primary signs was the inverted nipple. I don't know that we touched on the other signs, a lump obviously.
Right.
And we've got a list of them we're going to put up on the camera.
Right.
But a lump.
Scaling, redness, discharge.
Skin dimpling and puckering have there. Yeah.
So it's the same symptoms that women can experience.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just the male breast is much smaller. And there's much less tissue available, but because of that, because of less tissue, it can spread quicker than it does in females, and that's why it usually metastasizes to the lymph nodes or other parts of the body earlier in men. And that's
so the combination of delayed seeking health care and the aggressiveness of it, because it doesn't have as much tissue to go through,
right.
That creates quite a dangerous combination.
Yes, for men.
Yeah. I want to talk a little bit more about on your website. You've got about 9 tabs, or maybe even more than that.
Oh, 16.
16. Okay. And you've got signs and symptoms. You've got risk factors listed out. You have your story, which is a very interesting story. You have an opportunity then for other men to submit their stories.
Yes, we have 6 men that have told their story. And what we're trying to do is get other men comfortable, men with breast cancer, talk about it. The way we can increase the survival rate for men by about 9%, get it to where women is by getting knowledge,
mm-hmm.
getting information out there. So 5 years ago, I was reluctant to talk, and many men weren't willing to acknowledge it. Now more and more men are coming forward and saying, yes, I have breast cancer, and they're starting slowly to step out of that shell and say, let's get the information out.
Yeah, and that's where we started this conversation today, is at the proclamation for the County Commission. So the third week in October.
as Male Breast Cancer Awareness Week. So and that's what we're going to achieve, not trying, we're going to achieve within the next year.
Okay, well, I don't ever remember such a big Breast Cancer Awareness Month as this month was. So this is perfect that, you know, to start bringing this to light also, because it's obviously very important. If we can just close that gap between the 78 and the 87%
right.
success rates, that would be tremendous. Congratulations on your efforts. Another thing I want to just tap on real quick that I meant to get earlier. A moment ago, you said that a friend of yours had a 47-year-old husband who died of male breast cancer.
Right.
Is that correct? Now, 47, that's young, if I'm not mistaken, for male breast cancer.
Yes, but like everything else, ladies are being diagnosed earlier, and so are men. There's a gentleman in Kansas City, 24 years old, just recently diagnosed. He was at 17. There was a lump in his breast. He was told that he was just maturing.
Mm-hmm.
And 7 years he went without getting it really seriously looked at.
And it lived.
Wow. And he's now, you know, I think he's stage 2 or 3. It's caught early, and hopefully he will have. But he's going through chemotherapy, and which is not nice. It's nasty.
Yeah. Most all of us probably have known somebody who has gone through, you know, has had cancer and gone through chemotherapy. And I know that is something you definitely want to. We're blessed to have it, but it's something that is hard to go through. Not only for the individual going through it, but for family members as well.
Right.
Let's talk just a moment about family members. The support, your website, malebreastcancer.ca,
right.
That it provides support for family members as well?
Yes. Anybody that wants can call, text, email, and we will reply as soon as possible, usually within 24 hours, usually within 5 hours if I get an email. I will respond to people. And the whole idea is to say, yeah, what would, you know, if there's anything I can provide, if you want to know, I may not be, some other men are on tamoxifen, I was on Arimidex. I have four other men I know that are on tamoxifen. I'm in contact with them, and I can put. I was at a breast cancer Dragon Boat Festival in Peterborough in June, and put a gentleman from Australia in touch with a fellow in Chicago about tamoxifen.
Excellent.
And both the side effects they were fighting.
So they were able to provide support for each other.
Each other.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Now tell me about the presentation you're giving in June. You've been honored to be asked to present to a big operation.
I was asked to submit an abstract to give a presentation at the 6th World Conference on Breast Cancer in June next year, which is going to be held in Hamilton, Ontario.
Congratulations.
Very excited about that.
Yeah.
And as it is, it's just get the word out there. We can increase survival rate.
Yes. Now, are you available for let's say we have some folks watching today who have groups that meet on a regular basis and like to have speakers come in. Are you available to speak to
at
groups?
At any time. I will talk anytime, any place.
Okay. Yeah. I would think that, some of the men's group that meet regularly, it would be ideal to get you in some of those groups. Are you, now, to contact you, do you just go through the male
Breast Cancer CA has a contact tab on there, and fill out that, it'll come right to me.
Okay.
My cell phone number is on the website, whichever works.
Okay, great. I want to take, before we close up shop here, I want to take a few minutes just to review some of the important things we talked about today. One of them is the risk factors of male breast cancer. We talked about obesity, alcohol, genetics, family history, aging.
Right. We all, as we get older, everybody becomes susceptible.
The older we get, the closer we get. Right. Actually, one time I heard that the older you get, the longer you're expected to live, which I thought was pretty interesting. But what it's saying is the people who are hardy enough to live to be 84 are probably hardy enough to live to be 90. And I thought that was always very interesting.
It is. It's a neat idea. Yeah.
So we've got some of the risk factors we identified. Signs and symptoms we talked a little bit about,
right.
The lumps, the puckering.
Scaling and
the
puckering and discharge.
Right, yeah. Okay.
Itching is another one. It just any change. And get if you're not happy, get a second opinion.
Okay. One thing you have reiterated to me is how early diagnosis is key for male breast cancer.
It's the key for every cancer, but I'm not going to say more importantly, but it is very, very important for male breast cancer.
Okay.
Mainly because, you know, men are notorious for not seeking medical advice about anything and not talking to their spouse. And they're not going to talk to their spouse or a doctor about a breast issue unless they feel comfortable themselves to say, hey, there's something wrong here.
And that's what we're here to do today.
That's what we're here to do.
Yeah.
Get it looked at.
Well, Mr. Wagner, it has been delightful talking to you. I'm very appreciative for the work you're doing in our community. And I'm enlightened now. I can share some information and certainly share the website. For folks in the community that are watching this show today, or not even in the community, the web allows
anywhere
to tap into the resources you have. It allows this show to be presented everywhere and allows people to tap in anywhere.
Well, and with your permission, I will put a link on a page on our website about this interview and a link to it.
Right. I hope that it will be helpful
to
you. Others.
Yeah.
Once again, Mr. Herb Wagner is with A Man's Pink. It's a male breast cancer advocacy organization. He's got a very powerful website that's at malebreastcancer.ca, and we encourage viewers to watch, to go to that website and get a little more information on male breast cancer. More importantly, we want to start creating an awareness in the male population particularly, but even wives and mothers. To be aware that male cancer does occur in men and what we can do to help prevent it, what we can do to help diagnose it early, and what we can do once it has been diagnosed.
Just please take a moment and tell all the men involved in your life, your sons, your husbands, boyfriends, that breast cancer is a disease that can affect men. And that early diagnosis is the key to our survival.
Okay. Thank you for being a resource for our
community.
Thank
you so much for allowing me to be here.
Once again, I'm Ann Gail Ellis. I'm a health educator with the Hernando County Health Department, and you've been watching Healthy Hernando. Thank you for joining us, and we'll look forward to seeing you next time.